I believe with all my heart that the Bible says very clearly there will not be a pre-trib rapture. There will not be a mid-trib rapture. There will not be anything like that. I don't believe the Bible indicates anything like that coming before the second coming of Christ. I believe the second coming of Christ is the gathering of the saints. That will be when we are gathered to heaven. I believe the Bible is so clear on that. And so I want to talk about that, and maybe I might make a few videos in succession about that, God willing, if it's the good Lord's will. And I think that's what he's leading me to do right now, to talk about these things, because it's very important that we understand that we will be here in these last days, and we will be his witnesses in these last days. We will be about his business in these last days. We will be doing what God has called us to do. We're the last generation on this earth. In these last days, we're the last generation to be able to go out and win the lost for Christ and to harvest the last harvest for Christ. We are that generation, and it's so important that we understand. Now, there's two points I want to make first of all. These are, to me, the groundwork before we start talking about our disagreements. The most important thing is that we disagree in love, because, you know, I can tell you that putting videos on YouTube, I get comments from people calling themselves Christians that are the most hateful, the most sarcastic, the most rude and unkind and unloving comments. And you may say, well, they're not real Christians. You know, there, a lot of them, I'm sure, are not true Christians. But I can't help but wonder if some of them aren't true Christians that have just backslid and just have adopted the spirit of this world off of the YouTube and off of Twitter and Facebook and all these other forums, where people are just pitted against each other all the time in conflict, just fighting it out. Are you letting the spirit of this world infect you and turn you into something that you never should be? I just want to encourage you that we're not all going to agree on everything. You know, the old saying goes, you get four Christians together discussing something, four Christians, you're going to have five different opinions, because Christians are not all going to agree on everything. We're not going to be in perfect agreement on every detail. Read the book of Acts and read the epistles, and you see there was a lot of disagreement in the church, and some of the disagreement came from people who were not Christians. But some of the disagreement you can also read about was among Christians, like Paul and Barnabas. They disagreed so much that they had to split up, but it was God's will. He wanted one to go one way and one to go the other way. There's other places in the Bible where we find sharp disagreements. Peter and Paul had a sharp disagreement. You know, but sometimes there's a reason. But the point is, can we do that in love? Can we disagree with each other in love? Can you be a pre-trib Christian and me not be a pre-trib Christian? Can you still love me? I love you. I promise you that. You being a pre-trib Christian does not affect my love for you in any way, shape, or form. I still love you 100%. If you're a mid-trib Christian, I love you 100%. Whatever your thoughts are about the end times, let's disagree with each other in Christian love, and let's show each other that we love each other. That's the important thing. If we're not doing that, we're not worth anything. We're all going to be in heaven someday, and we want to be able to be there and say, praise God, we loved each other when we were in this world. We did not let our disagreements over some doctrine or issue, we didn't let that spoil our witness and our love for one another. So let's, whatever, that's one thing I hope you understand. I love you. I love you in Christ. I don't care what all the fine points of your theology are on the end times. I love you. And second thing I really think is important to make clear before I get into this series of whatever you believe about how long we're going to be here, how long before the Lord gathers us and takes us home and out of this world, however long you think it's going to be, I want to encourage you that don't think for one minute that it's all about doom and gloom and dreadful, dreadful times. Brothers and sisters, this is an idea that has been foisted upon us, and false prophets are putting this out. This is not what the Bible says. Let me bring this to your attention to help you maybe get some perspective here on this. Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and he knew that was his main mission, to come into the world and lay down his life on the cross and suffer and die for our sins. He knew that. He told his disciples he was going to do that. He knew he was going to do that. He knew that for the 3 years that he ministered, and the 3 years of his ministry, his public ministry. He knew that. But remember, that was just one day that he would do that. They only could kill him one time. He was crucified one time on one day, and for 3 years, he was a witness, he was a minister, he was spreading the gospel, he was healing, he was working miracles. He was about God's business for 3 years before they put him to death on that one day. And so I just want to encourage you, even if God calls me to lay down my life for Christ, even if God calls you to lay down your life for Christ, that's just going to be one day that you're going to do that. You're only going to be laying down your life one day. All these other days of our life, we are going to be living for Christ. We're going to be witnessing. We're going to be ministering up until the day God calls us home. So it's not going to be all doom and gloom and terrible times and horror and everything. And we're not going to be under the wrath of God. Some people I know say that, well, if you think you're going to be here, then you must think you're going to be under the wrath of God. Of course not. No Christian is ever under the wrath of God. We're not under the wrath of God now. I'm not under the wrath of God right now. I'm not going to be under the wrath of God at any time. When the wrath of God is falling upon the earth, Christians are not under the wrath of God. You know, when the Israelites were in the land of Goshen, and God sent the plagues down upon the Egyptians, the Israelites weren't under the wrath of God. Those plagues didn't fall on the Israelites. The wrath of God is not going to fall on God's children, not the wrath of God. Now, there will be persecution of Christians. Yes, Christians are persecuted now. People who love the Lord are being persecuted and put to death in countries around the world right now. And so we've got to understand that there's, you know, the wrath of God is one thing. We are not under the wrath of God. But persecution, Jesus said there would be persecutions. There's going to be persecutions. These are two separate things. But the point I'm making here is, don't look at these end times as if, my goodness, this is awful, we're living in the end times. Just the opposite. This is wonderful. We're living in the end times. We are the generation that is called to be living in the end times, to be the witnesses to the last time, the last generation. We are his witnesses. We are the people who are called to spread the gospel to all the world, and then the end will come, Jesus said. So we've got a wonderful future. And if God says this day, Jim, you're going to go home, this is the time for you to come home. If God says that, that will be the time when I go home. But until that time, let's be bold, let's be brave, let's be Christians, let's be witnesses. Somebody might say, well, Brother Jim, you're telling people that Donald Trump is the Antichrist. If Donald Trump is the Antichrist, you'll be the first to go. That may happen. Here's the way I look at that. A lot of people may think, well, the people that are most outspoken, the people that are most bold, the people that are the strongest witnesses will be the first to go because the devil will want to get them out. Yeah, the devil might want to get them out, but God Almighty don't want to get them out. The Lord Almighty wants his witnesses to be here, and the Lord Almighty is in control. Now, the Lord Almighty just might say, okay, if this person is bold and witnessing and speaking up, I'm going to protect that person and I'm going to keep that person from being the first to go because I can use this person to win somebody else to Christ. But if you're hiding and shrinking back and saying, I'm not going to say anything, I'm not going to be a bold Christian, I'm going to try to hide and I'm going to try to be keeping a low profile and maybe I'll be spared, maybe they won't come get me. If that's your attitude, God may just say, well, I don't need that person. He's not witnessing for the Lord. She's not telling people about Christ. She's living in fear. He's living like he doesn't want to speak up for me. Then, what do I need that person in this world for? You may be the first to go. So, let's be bold. Let's be brave. Let's be strong. Let's be courageous. Let's speak up. Let's take our stand. Let's not be afraid. Let's speak the word of God. And whenever it's our time to go, it's our time to go. The Bible says, some will go into captivity. Some will go into the sword. Some will be here when the Lord comes back. The Bible is very clear. At the second coming of Jesus Christ, there will be Christians on this earth still. So there's going to be different experiences for all of God's children. But the experience is going to be wonderful if you will let it be. If you will say, Holy Spirit, fill me and give me a bold and courageous witness. Help me to speak in these last days and not be afraid and not fear. Help me not to be looking at the day that I might be called home or might have to lay down my life for the Lord. If I lay down my life for the Lord, that will be wonderful too. You can read about many people who have laid down their lives for the Lord and did it with boldness and courage, the Holy Spirit strengthening them. And you know that God will be merciful. God will not be cruel or unkind to you. God will give you the grace. He will give you the power. He will give you the strength. The Bible says he will give us the words to say when our persecutors persecute us and if we're hauled before kings or magistrates, whatever, God will give us the very words to say to be a witness to them and to stifle all opposition. And maybe they'll put me to death. Praise God, I know where I'm going. I've got a home in heaven. And God will give us the courage, and God will give us the strength, and God will give us the grace. God will see us through that. So don't be living in fear, thinking about what may happen or what may come. Look at the apostles in the book of Acts, how they lived each day. We know that from history that almost every one of the apostles were martyred. They gave their lives for the Lord. They laid down their lives for the Lord. Don't be afraid of it. Don't be afraid because God is our courage. God is our strength. God is the one who will uphold us and take care of us, and we will live in courage, and we will be his witnesses day by day by day. The apostles were his witnesses, and they didn't think about the day that they might lay down their lives for the Lord. They were just thinking about doing the Lord's business today, being a witness, being a minister, fulfilling the will of God until the day that they were called home. So have courage and be strong and let's love one another as we go through this world. We may not agree on how it's all going to come out, but it's going to be as it will be, as God has decreed it will be. And I want to talk to you, if God is willing, in some future videos, I want to talk to you more about these things and about how I believe what the Bible says is that we will be here. And we're going to be his witnesses, and we're going to be doing his work to the very end till the Lord comes back again at the second coming of Christ. And it's going to be wonderful. It's going to be great. It's going to be wonderful. And we're saved by grace, brothers and sisters, not because we are being strong or being faithful or because we're doing anything good. I've heard people say that, oh, if you think that we're going to be here, then you must think you're saved by your works or by your faithfulness. No, we're saved by grace. We're all saved by the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name, thank you for your love, and thank you for being the people of God that you are. Thank you, brothers and sisters. I love you so much. You have no idea how much I pray for you and how much I love you. And I would like to have a word of prayer with you right now. Father, I thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ. And I thank you, Lord God, that we can love one another. We may not agree on everything, but we can love one another. And Lord God, we're going into these last days, and we pray, Lord God, that you give us wisdom. Guide us and show us what's right from wrong. Give us the truth. Show us, Lord God, so that we can help others to see the way. Give us the words to say to win that lost soul to Christ and to be upbuilders of one another, encouraging one another, and above all, giving you all the glory, exalting the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who died on the cross, who gave everything he could give, poured out his blood with all the love of God. Everything that he could do, he did on that cross, and he did it for us. Lord, we thank you, Father, and we love you, Lord, in Jesus' precious name. Strengthen us now in Christ in these days to come. In Jesus' precious name, amen.